Very good afternoon to all present over here. This is Deepika Nandanwar from G.H. Rai Sohi University of Management and Research. Today, I'm welcoming you all in a very interesting session, a virtual Orange City Literature Festival. This session will be of 40 minutes. And today, we have a very interesting topic, which is the longest kiss, the life and times of Devika Rani, which is conducted by one and only Kishwar Desai. She is an award-winning author and playwright who writes both fiction and non-fiction. Her latest book, The Longest Kiss, The Life and Times of Devika Rani, based on the personal papers and letters of the iconic actress, will be published by early December. The book has emerged from a 15-year search for documents and material. Ma'am worked in television as an anchor and producer for over 20 years before becoming a writer. Ma'am is the author of Darling Ji, True Story of Nargis and Sunil Dutt, 2007. Her novel Witness, The Night, won the Costa First Novel Award in the UK in 2010 and was followed by two others, Origins of Love, 2012, and The Sea of Innocence, 2013. The trilogy featuring Simran Singh has since been optioned for a web series. Most recently, in 2019, her play Devika Rani, Goddess of the Silver Screen, produced by Lilith Dubey, was successfully staged in venues across India. We also having with us our dear moderator, Shikha Khar, an entrepreneur and trainer for various skill development programs since last 15 years. In 1,000 plus candidates to become job ready. Key member of Vidarbha Industries Association Marketing Forum. Now, I would like to hand over this session over to you guys.
Thank you so much, Deepika. And a very warm welcome to all the audience who are here watching us live on Sunday afternoon. You know, good to see you all virtually this time. And I would say I am super excited to share a screen with Kishwar Desai ma'am and to moderate this session. Super excited as the name of the book that we are going to discuss today, Longest Kiss, Life and Times of Devika Rani. So without wasting any time, you know, I have lots of questions and let's jump on with the conversation with Lady Desai, Kishwar Desai. So you started your career as a print journalist. You worked in a media house, you know, you worked as an anchor for Doordarshan, and you went on to become the vice president of Zee Telefilms. When did you discover your passion for writing?
Thank you so much, Shikha. It's lovely to be on the show. Thank you, Deepika, for this lovely introduction. And of course, many thanks to the Orange Literature Festival. I've been here last year, but when we were physically present, but it's very interesting to be here this time in a virtual way. Well, it's a question that, you know, takes me back a long way into my own life. My desire to become a writer was actually when I was 10 years old, you know, and I used to keep a diary. And at that time, I recently found the diary, and it was very, very touching to see that almost every page I had written the synopsis of a book that I would write when I was grown up. So this was at the age of 10. I had already started plotting and planning the kind of novels that I would write and so on. So I think my passion for becoming a writer goes back a long time, because I used to write poetry as a kid. I also used to participate in a lot of competitions. I used to write plays, act, etc. So I think my passion for literature and interest never went away, even though I did a lot of other things. And Shikha, as you know, as somebody who's participated in media herself, is that when even when you are in television Actually, you're doing a lot of writing because I started as a script writer and then I went on to become an anchor and a producer. But every story you do, no matter whether it is a new story or whatever, it requires a script. It requires a beginning, a middle, and an end. So I think the writing never really stopped, even when I was doing television for over 25 years. But I think the kind of television that I saw happening, my changeover took place about 16, 17 years ago, I realized the sort of television I was passionate about was not the kind of television I saw. And in recent years, I think my fear is even more real because what we had idealistically begun working on as television professionals, I started like 30, 40 years back, you know, before any one of you were probably born, either of you were born. At that time, we had a different kind of idealism. Now, this sort of television that happens, I can't really relate to it. So I think it was good.
It was in a way right move. But then I have a question here. You know, there is this drastic change when you're working in a media house. You are day in and day out interacting with a lot of people. And as far as writing is concerned, I think, you are supposed to be all by yourself. You don't need any distraction. So, how did you adapt to this drastic change, or you were in for it? How did it go?
It was very difficult. Yes, you're quite right. Because when I was working with Zee Telefilms, I had an office where there were about 100 people working all the time. And I had that kind of a glass office where anybody, you know, it was transparent. Anyone could see me. I could see them. We would have meetings throughout the day. I was running a channel. So definitely that was very high adrenaline. You know, that kind of work requires constant interaction. My phone would not stop ringing the whole day. So the question of writing was impossible. The kind of writing I'm doing now, I was writing then as well, but different sorts of things, as I said. Now I needed to take a lot of time out, spend time by myself. So I did it in two stages. What I did was I joined a publishing house because I thought that, you know, from there I can build up the discipline to be by myself. Because when you're working on other people's books, you also have to be able to concentrate. You also have to be, you know, give full respect to their work, etc. And that would help me transition into my own space. As a kid, I used to spend a lot of time when I used to write my poetry and short stories. So I needed to go back to that stage and phase again where I could be by myself. So I think that transition helped. For about a year, I worked in a publishing house, and then I was just ready to get into the world of writing because by that time I was able to stay calmly in a room without getting disturbed. And also, don't forget, I am a mother. I'm a mother of two children who are grown up now.
So you don't look like them. You don't look like them.
All working women. I went through a phase when I had to deal with a lot of stuff going on around me, but I was constantly working, even working from home. Those days I was writing articles, shorter articles. So I got used to multitasking, you know? So you're somewhere in a woman's mind is the ability to deal with many things as well as get into her own space when it is required. So I think the transition was
nice. Correct. I am in sync with what you are saying. So, but looking at the kind of Simran Singh series, especially that, you know, you came up with, be it Sea of Innocence or Witness the Night, if they have actually covered all feminist topics, or you have actually tried to bring up, might be you talked about surrogacy, or you've talked about the rape case, or you've talked about so basically you're trying to some social topic, some awareness on how women are supposed to get equal rights or the problems that they are facing. But how did you decide, these are amazing books, how did you decide that, you know, I have to start with this is what has touched my heart?
Well, to begin with, the Simran series came after the first book, which I'd written, which was on Nargis and Sunil Dutt, and that was a very, very tough book to write. You know, it was because anytime you do nonfiction, and I came from a journalistic background, so definitely I was of the view that I could not write a gossipy book. I had to write a well-researched book. So when I started working on the story of Nargis and Sunil Dutt, I went out and I did 50 hours of interviews with everybody in the family, including Sanjay Dutt, including the sisters, Priya Dutt and Namrata, and then all the family members. I spent up to almost 8 to 9 months in Bombay, meeting lots and lots of people, researching. And I was also given Sunil Dutt and Nargis's personal papers and diaries to sort of base my book, because I wanted it to be an authentic book. So I wrote that. I wrote it in about 6 months, but it was grueling. So when I came out of that, I wanted to write something which was not as grueling, but equally some subject that I felt passionately about. Writing that book, the first book, and the kind of response it gave made me more confident about my writing, because that was my first book. And so I picked up a subject that I used to upset me a lot, which is the subject of female feticide and infanticide, from the state that I belong to, Punjab and Haryana, where the gender imbalances are terrible. I mean, there are villages that have not seen the birth of a baby girl, you know, for years. And only recently has the situation changed. And that applies to Rajasthan, it applies to, in just today I was reading about this poor woman who killed 4 of her daughters because she felt that I can't bear a son. So she killed So I felt that I needed to write something that I had been very upset by. And that was the first book which I wrote, Witness the Night, of the Simran Singh series. Simran Singh is like a social worker come detective. She goes into a particular situation not knowing what is going to be. She's a bit of a, you know, happy-go-lucky type. But then...
Sorry to interrupt you here, but... is Simran Singh an extension of, or is it somewhere, is she like you, you know, your protagonist, Simran Singh?
Not at all. I'm far too serious. You know, I'm far too serious. I let her do whatever I would have loved to do in my own life, many things. But I think, you know, sorry, there's some sort of fly right around here. But what I tried to do very much was my own, I think you always project onto various characters that you're writing, especially when you're working on your first novel. And this was my first novel. So there were many people that I took inspiration from all around me, a lot of good women, a lot of social workers, etc. So this was like a crime thriller. And then what happened was people loved it so much that I got a contract from Simon & Schuster, who said that they wanted 2 more books. So it's like an author's dream. You get a 3-deal contract for a large amount of money. And I said, wow, this is fantastic. This
Congratulations on that. Yeah.
That's a long time back.
But there's an additional 4th one coming in a row, or we have just, I mean, Simran Singh series is a book of set of 3.
No, I will be writing more. And now it's being made into a web series. So I'm just looking, I'm hoping that by the time the web series is made, there will be a renewed interest in Simran Singh. But what happened was, in between, then I worked with a team and we set up the Partition Museum in Amritsar, which was actually a lot of hard work. And I think I spent two years of my life just doing nothing else but that. So I'm the chair of the trust that runs the museum. And it's the world's only museum on the partition of India. So, you know, it was quite a task, because we had to set it up without any money, without any support from the government, etc. But we did it. And it is now, recently, it's won about 6 or 7 national and international awards, and right now being again nominated for another one. But
Congratulations, I said, on that. Yeah, amazing. Yeah. Yes.
But then the next book I did was on Jallianwala Bagh, you know, because when we were working on the Partition Museum, and we were working in Amritsar, we realized that there was so much that people didn't know about the massacre that took place in Jallianwala Bagh. And then the team and I started researching on it, and we found more and more things. I mean, every day we would discover new information. And so then I ended up writing a book, and that's how Simran...
So that is this Jallianwala Bagh that came in, and Simran Singh series, maybe we will soon see another one coming up.
Yes.
There is a question, Keeshwa, that I would like to ask. You know, in your book about Sunil Dutt, let's come back to Darling Ji now. So, who decides on the name, Darling Ji and the longest kiss? You know, I really want to know, and I'm sure the audience wants to know. You know, how do you decide, or who do you discuss it with your husband? He's also a writer, so you know, you have this. I'm coming up with this book, and how does it work?
No, I think the names, like the book, I'm very lucky that way, that all the names and the way the book flows happens quite naturally. I mean, I don't, you know, the Darling Ji came out one of the letters that they had written to each other. They used to, Narges and Sunil Dutt were immensely romantic. They were very much in love with each other. And they used to address each other as Darling Ji and Love Ji and all that, you know, so it was very sweet. So I thought, it's a romantic, I'm a romantic, I'm very happy to be a romantic. So I thought that, you know, it's a nice way, the book itself, even though it talks about the lives of two very interesting actors who saw a lot of changes in India, and one was a Hindu, one was a Muslim, and how they built their lives together. It's quite a powerful story, but at the same time, I wanted to highlight the fact that despite everything, they also had a deep love for each other. And I think it talks about cinema, it talks about a lot of things. But for as far as The Longest Kiss is concerned, which is my new book, which is on Devika Rani, this is something I'm utterly, utterly passionate about. And it is a book that I've spent like 15 years, you know, trying to find information.
Oh, is it? Is it?
Devika is a, you know, she's been a very, very underrated actress and producer, because she actually did a lot to change the face of Indian cinema. But because she was a recluse for so many years, after she left Bollywood, after she left Bombay Cinema, Bombay Talkies, and went off with her husband Svetoslav Rurik, the Russian artist, and she started living in the hills in Kulu Manali, and then later on they moved to Bangalore. She became a recluse. So I think the industry more or less did not realize what a large legacy she had left behind. So I think it was a very exciting book for me to write, because people had a lot of misconceptions about her, which I'm very happy through this book I have been able to correct. And I think it will, and because again, I was fortunate, I got, like in Narges's case, I got access to her personal letters, the letters that she herself had written describing her life and herself, and all that she had been through, you know, all the years that she was in cinema. And it was a very hard and a very traumatic life. She was the great grandniece of Rabindranath Tagore, but she was somehow not willing to live. And you know, aajkal ye baat chalti hai about how beta, baap, everybody's together in the film industry, you know, there is a line. But she didn't want to be part of a dynasty. She didn't want to use the Tagore name. She didn't even attach it to her name. She just was herself. She was completely independent. And she reached the highest, you know, she was the head of Bombay Talkies at the age of 34, 35. No woman has, as far as I know, has ever headed a publicly, you know, owned company at the age of 35 or in her own right, you know. So this was something quite amazing. Yeah,
absolutely. She, you know, at a very young age, she did went abroad, and I think she did her filmmaking program also from abroad. And I think it's really a nice topic that you have chosen, and people really need to know. Now, the other day when I was asked to moderate this program, I was actually talking to my daughter, and I told her about Devika Rani, and she's like, Mama, I don't know. So I think, you know, really you have done a fab job of picking up this lady who is the one who has paved way for actresses, and at yeah. that point of time, when you know, you really can't imagine a kissing scene. She had this longest kissing scene, of course, with her husband. But I think you have done a fab job of picking up this topic and bringing out in public. And good that you have access to all the personal documents. So we have a lovely thing coming up to read in your future. So it's coming up in December or January, right?
Yes, it will be out by that time, because as I said, it has taken a long time to put together. And you're right, in those days, you know, a kiss between, it didn't matter, between a husband and wife, because on screen they're shown as lovers. So this was something very disconcerting for the Indian audience. But it was also a time in 1933 when this film of hers came out called Karma. It was also a time in India where there were a lot of foreign entrepreneurs who used to come in, and but particularly you know, directors, producers, camera people who used to come and work with it was a very different film industry at that time. The people used to come from abroad and actually work in studios here. Bombay Talkies itself had Germans working with them, had British people working with them, and so on. So as a result, you had a very international production that she and her husband worked with, especially Karma, which was shot partly in India and partly in the UK. And, you know, I can tell you, Shikha, that kind of praise, oh my God, you read the reviews, no Indian actress has ever got. And from whom? Not from an Indian audience, not from Indian critics, but from the critics in Britain, who watched this film and said, oh my God, a star has risen in the East. This woman is so lovely. She's going to be the next star of Hollywood. And she immediately started getting amazing offers. So, you know, when we talk today about our actors and actresses doing well abroad, I wish somebody remembered Devika, because she actually got
you are doing that job. I think you're doing a fab job. You know, when we are talking about, you might be Priyanka Chopra doing so well abroad, and you're coming up with, you know, it's not just happening today, it was way back. You know, Devika Rani had already set up things and she was praised at that point of time. I think you're doing a fab job. Can we also know, you know, for this, you did, because the pandemic was going on, did it in any which ways help you finish the book? You did research for 15 years though. Yeah. But compiling the book, has a pandemic, corona time helped you in actually sitting and, you know, without any distraction, writing down, penning down this book?
Actually, this book wouldn't have been written without the pandemic, I have to admit that. Because this was an immense, you see, I had collected over 15 years, because I'd been researching this for 15 years, I had collected something like 4,000 documents. And these were not just single page documents. They were like documents which sometimes her own letters were sometimes 30 pages long. And so I had to sit and read all this material. And I had written a bit about her a little while, you know, a few years ago, but I was not able to ever get the time to take out. I had two suitcases full of documents. So as a result, I didn't need to go out and research. All the research was with me. I had all the books with me. And I had these two suitcases that I was traveling around with all the time, looking for a place to sit down and write, you know, because it meant making the house into a huge mess, because the papers were in every room. They were in the bedrooms, they were in the dining room. My husband got used to eating his food in a very little cramped. And my children were very accommodating. If they were visiting, they would be careful. Acha, mama, yeah, your papers are lying here. Can we sit here? You know, because the papers were everywhere. The pandemic was very helpful because we had no jharu pocha wali coming. We had nobody to come and dust the house, nothing. Oh, there were only papers and papers everywhere. So it was like, for me, a blessing in disguise. And I could actually concentrate because the phone was not ringing. I could easily tell any friend who wanted to, how can we meet? We can't meet. There were no dinners, there were no lunches, nothing. So the 6 months or 7 months that I spent working on this book during the pandemic, maybe 6 months, including the editing, it was extremely useful. I could work from 8 o'clock in the morning to 2 in the morning or 3 in the morning.
Without any distraction.
Like a 24-hour cycle.
Down the clock, yes.
Yeah, without any worries. So it helped. It was immensely, immensely helpful. Yeah.
So other things like Ishwar is, at that point of time, you know, you were not traveling. So, you know, you had the entire mess in the home, you were saying. But is there any location, like, you know, authors say this, you know, main hafe baitta hu to mujhe bahut acche se idea aate hain, ya mujhe raat ko idea aata hai, you know, I run for a book and, you know, I just want to jot down that idea. So if you can just share such experiences, is there a particular place which you like sitting and writing and, you know, the ideas pour in? So how does it happen?
No, I think each of my books has been written in a different space, actually, because we do live in London. We also have a house in Goa. My parents live in Delhi. So it all depends on where I am at that time. And as I said, like normally I use the dining table now a lot, both in UK as well as in Delhi, because earlier I used to, you know, in London, I have a room, a kind of an office space where I have my desk, and it's a big mess. It's always in a mess because I never clear up, because I always think, oh, I might need this paper, you know, I might need this particular. So it's always, and the maid has strict instructions, ke ye desk ko tum bilkul mat chuna. He just leaves it like that for years. Usko koi chuta nahi hai. You know, the only person who's allowed to touch it is me. But I found that though I did Darling Ji, wrote Darling Ji there, but it was also, it was a little isolated. It was away from the rest of the house. And because I didn't go out for 6 months when I was writing Darling Ji, I barely went out. I felt I got very isolated while writing that. So now I've changed things. Now I work on the dining table downstairs in our house in London, and in the house in Delhi. And that I find very good, because there are things happening around me. I'm not isolated, but I'm in my own world.
Okay, and you know, Darling Ji again brings a question to my mind. You know, generally, there is this, main 20 rupees leke aaya Bombay, and then, you know, most of the actors, jinka bhi aap dekhe, bahut famous ho gaye hain, so they are like, they came with might be 20 rupees, or they came up with, you know, 100 rupees in their pocket, and they came and they became big stars. Of course, they had talent in them. Of course, they had this willpower in them. So, Sunil Dutt ki, Darling Ji ki, yadi hum baat karte hain, so unke baare mein thoda sa describe karte hain.
Yes, I mean, he had a similar story, because actually he was a victim of partition. You know, he was forced to leave. His family was forced to leave all their lands behind in what is now Pakistan. And they had to come away, and they had to live in a refugee camp. So all those descriptions are in my book, you know, what happened and how he rose. They were big landowners, once upon a time in Jhelum, where he grew up. And there are lovely descriptions in the book about his childhood and how he grew up. But once they lost everything, he actually came to Bombay looking for a job. He didn't want to become a film star.
Okay.
Unlike the other people who... He came with 50 rupees. That's also in my book.
Yeah.
How he came with 50 rupees in his pocket. But he became a bus conductor. His first job was as a bus conductor. He worked at the BST. You know, he could just... Whenever he got a job, and then, but he was also in college at that time. He was, going to college, and it is there while he was comparing a show that, he got picked up for Radio Ceylon, as it was called at that time. They liked his voice, and they said, why don't you become a compere for this, the song thing which they had of Hindi film songs. So he became a compere there, and he was a big fan of Nargis. He had never met her, but he always, like, used to go and hang around her house and say, one day I'll meet her, you know, that kind of thing. Slowly, he got a break in cinema. She was already a big star by then. She had done lots and lots of films. She was a big star. He was nobody. So when they met, on the sets of Mother India, where he actually, and that is how my book opens. So if you read the first few chapters of my book, you will find Narges's actual thoughts, because I got it out of her diary, where she'd written how she actually felt when she was surrounded by those flames in Mother India. You've seen that film, what was that film that came out on Bollywood, which Farah Khan had made, you know, where the scene is replicated, where Deepika Padukone is surrounded by flames and this, you know, Shah Rukh Khan jumps in and rescues her.
Yes, correct. The name escapes my mind. Yes, I've seen that film.
That was taken from the real life incident which had taken place between Narges and Sunil Dutt, and he had rescued her. And that is when they were recuperating, you know, for in a little village away from where the shoot was taking place, that they fell in love. So all those things are in the book, you know, and that's why I said it. That's why it's called Darling Ji. But it's true. When he came, he had nothing, and then he worked hard.
That works really well for people. And whenever you want to really become big, I think it works well for you. You have this small little amount, and you move to Mumbai. I think a lot of them have made fortunes later. So I think we have 10 minutes left. So I'll be asking you more questions now. Out of your book, your own books, all right, which is your personal favorite?
Well, I think definitely one that I have written right now. This is the one that I absolutely am passionate about. I adore this woman. I think Devika, as I said, is a heroine in my eyes. She's a very normal woman. I mean, she's not somebody who doesn't have flaws. She has a lot of flaws. She's gray all the time. But the thing is that she is somebody who fights for her rights. So the important thing that you will find that when you do read this book, why I like it so much, is that one, I feel it is authentic, because again, it is taken largely from her letters and from the, you know, the narrations of people who knew her. But apart from that, the reason is that she was a survivor. You know, in Bollywood, you get a lot of stories, and in all cinema, because cinema is a very, very hard and very difficult area to work in. And so people who are there need to be very resilient. You know, otherwise, I mean, we had this very tragic case of, you know, SSR recently.
Do you plan to write anything on something to do with Sushant's thing or...
No, I'm saying that because cinema puts a lot of pressure on people. So she herself went through a lot of, she was also a victim of domestic abuse. You know, she was beaten up by her husband many times, and yet she did not stop acting. She decided that she was going to be an independent woman. She was not going to be dependent on anyone. She wanted to be financial. In those days, I'm talking about 1930s, 40s. And she's trying to make a career from a very, very, in a very difficult area. So sometimes she was exceedingly lonely. She was by herself, but she didn't give up. So she did not become Ameena Kumari, who unfortunately took to alcoholism. You know, even Narges went through times, which you'll find in my book, where she wanted to kill herself. Because these areas, you know, working as a woman in cinema can be exceedingly heartbreaking, even for men. We've had cases like even Guru Dutt and so on. So some of those you will find in my book, including Himanshu Rai, her own husband. He also has a nervous breakdown while, you know, they're making these films in Bombay Talkies, because it's very tough. You know,
I completely agree there. You know, we've recently seen cases where people have got into drugs, and we have seen SSR case, and completely agree with you there. We are short of time, and there is one question that has come here. Your inspiration for writing these books. So, that's a question that's being asked by the audience.
Okay, so one of the things I would like to say specifically about the Devika Rani book, The Longest Kiss, The Life and Times of Devika Rani, the inspiration was that when I was actually visiting the National Film Archives in Pune, I was doing some other research, and I keep across the films which had been made in 1926, 1927, this is almost 100 years ago. I was looking at those films which are made by Himanshu Rai and then later on Devika Rani in Bombay Talkies and otherwise. And I was like shocked that why aren't these people being recognized for the great amount of work that they have done, the legacy. And you know, to the legacy, I want to add the point which you made, that she was a breakthrough person because she was educated. She came from an illustrious family. You cannot do better than come from the family of Rabindranath Tagore. And yet she enters cinema, but she makes it very clear. One of her proposals right at the start is, and she tells Himanshu over and over again, we must get educated women into cinema. We must change the perception of cinema, because in those days, cinema was only considered, you know, tawaif kaam karti hain, or, you know, prostitutes work there. So this was the impression that people had. So from coming from an illustrious family going there. So my inspiration of writing this book was Devika and her husband Himanshu Rai and the hard work that they had put in to lay the basis for Bombay Talkies, which made some excellent films in the 1920s, 30s, and 40s. And I think this was why I wrote the book, because I felt that these heroes need to be recognized.
Yeah, I think on this quick, we'll have a rapid fire round. You know, there are certain questions which are there. So I will cover that in rapid fire itself. Which is your, what's your favorite food?
Food.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I like Goan prawn curry.
Goan prawn curry. Okay. Favorite holiday destination?
Goa.
Goan prawn curry, Goa. Okay. Yeah, you have a Portuguese kind of the villa out there in Goa. So, yeah.
It's a very old house. It's very ramshackle, but it's there. Yes, yes.
Yeah. Who's your favorite author?
My favorite author. Well, my husband recently nominated me as one of his favorite authors, so I have to return the call.
So you played skip that. All right. Okay.
Meghnad Desai.
Okay, Meghnad Desai. All right. Favorite actor.
Favorite actor. Now that's a very difficult one. Lot of people come to mind.
Kishore, this is a rapid fire thing. You were supposed to give it a
I have no time to think. Okay, I think
I don't want to give you time to think. You immediately have to come up with that thing.
Okay.
What's on your mind? Come on, quickly.
Dilip Kumar.
All right. And Meghnad sir has written a book on it, which you were editing. Yes. So I get the point there. And who's your favorite moderator?
Moderator. Okay, you.
Okay, there's another question. Sorry, that was just. We have one more question to go. Which actor or actress in the Bollywood you would like to write the book on? You have already written on Deepika Rani, and you have already written on Nargis ji and Sunita ji. So we have the viewers want to know which is the next one in series.
More after this? I think a book on, now you're going to say that I'm thinking too much, but honestly speaking, the book that I wanted to write, I've already written. So it was Devika. I mean, I can't really think of anybody else.
Now, there's just one last question. What is that one topic that you don't want to write a book?
Don't want to write a book.
Don't want to write a book.
Sorry, I couldn't hear you. You're saying what is the one
topic? Just one topic. Just one book, please, Raja.
About going to the moon. I don't want to write much about going to the moon.
So I think we were not left with time when I wanted you to reach experts from your book. Do we have time, Deepika? Can we take it now?
Do we have time? No, ma'am. We only left with 1 minute.
Yeah. All right. In that case, I think we will put a full stop here. It was really nice talking to you, Kishwar, for the session.
And,
thank you so much.
All right. And, I will hand over to Deepika now.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
On behalf of Orange City Literature Festival, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a lovely session.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Two universities, 23 educational institutes, offering 137 courses. Raisoni Group of Institutions, a vision beyond.